Hi, my name is Gary Mann. I'm a retired principal and educator of 32 years. One of my passions and hobbies throughout my life has been collecting, and which culminated in my Elvis collecting that I've been doing for about the last 35 to 40 years. I arrived at the point where I found an interest between collecting and my other passion, which was music. I would say it was a lot more fun collecting 20 and 30 years ago because it was a process. When I collected, if I was collecting Elvis's movies, now you would just go into a store or online and say, I want the 32 movies that he made. When I was collecting, you had to go everywhere looking for the movies, not only around here in the big cities, but into the States. And I might find one movie 1 month and another movie. It probably took me about 4 years to collect the 32 movies versus getting them all in one shot. So it was more of a process, and that's what I enjoyed, was the actual hunt, finding the articles and then bringing them down. And then the second part was, how do you display them? Bringing them home and just putting them in a pile wasn't enough. I decided at one point, I told my wife, the rec room is going to be themed with music, particularly Elvis. It'll be a rec room you won't see anywhere else. I joined a dance band as a drummer in 1968. I was only 17 years old, and the singer in the band was an Elvis fan. And the only thing I knew about Elvis was the movies he had put out in the 1960s, which were basically almost comedy flicks. So as a musician, I didn't really think that much of him. But he talked me into watching the Singer special, which now is called the 68 Comeback Special. And I was so impressed once I saw that special as to what Elvis had done, the transition he had made from that movie era into the King of Rock and Roll again, that I started following his career. It was amazing what he was able to do. And he just started setting the trends in music, whether it be the jumpsuits that he was doing, the touring. And the fans, I guess, were always there, but when he made the comeback, it seemed that everyone was rooting for him. And if you watch the original show that he did in Vegas, when he made his comeback in Vegas, in the audience were guys like Sammy Davis Jr. and Tom Jones and Cary Grant. They were all there to see the King come back and make it. I think the longevity and the fact that he was able to renew himself at least three times, early rock, movie era, and Vegas Elvis. That makes a difference. Most of the people can't do that. I'd say most of it would be found in flea markets. There was actually two sources. One I would find in flea markets and fairs, etc. And the other source were all the people I knew. It became quickly known throughout the board that we've got an Elvis principal in our board. And I would often open up the courier bag and I would find these license plates up here. I didn't buy any of those. Those would come with a note, sometimes not even signed. I was somewhere and saw this, thought of you immediately, thought you might like it for your collection. This is the original first LP put out by RCA when they bought Elvis's contract from Sam Phillips at Sun Records. So this is 1956, and this isn't a remake, this is the real deal. I have a couple items that are favorite. On the wall behind me, these black records are 78 records. These particular records were all cut in the first session of Elvis with RCA in 1956. If you check the serial numbers on them, Jailhouse Rock, Hound Dog, Don't Be Cruel, you'll find the serial numbers in that book from the first session in the spring with RCA. Probably the thing that I value most and is worth nothing monetarily is a set of drumsticks I have autographed by DJ Fontana, Elvis's first drummer. I was able to meet him a few years ago along with Scotty Moore, the guitar player who just passed away. So I met both of these men, got their autographs, and have this pair of sticks that DJ Fontana autographed. And that's probably the most valuable thing to me as a musician that I have. This is one of the favorites of my grandchildren when they came over when they were a little younger. This was something that they had to play with each time they came in the rec room. They loved the part when Grandpa could make them stop dancing. All I had to do was point to them and then start them again. Yeah, I think about this collection. I've had it for probably 30, 40 years, and I find myself still coming down here some afternoons and just sitting here and looking around, because just about every single thing here has a story on how I found it or who gave it to me. And now getting to the age I am, what's coming across my mind, and my wife keeps reminding me, what are you going to do with all this stuff? It's great that you collected it and have it. I don't think my children are too interested in it. My son, who's a musician, there's certain things he'd like to see. And I've kind of fantasized about what could happen with this collection. What I'd like to see is I'd like to see it on display somewhere. I've thought of things like going to one of these restaurants like Angels that have the 50s decor and saying, would you like to take this collection and put it on display in your restaurant? Is there a museum area? Is there a music place? I'd hate to see it just sold off and split up. I kind of agonize over this regularly, what I'm going to do with it, and I haven't decided yet what's going to happen to the collection.